Well, you join me today here on the new Junction Canal. What an absolutely beautiful piece of water this is. And we're going to talk all about bream and skimmer fishing on this style of natural venue. There's lots of these big canals up and down the country, even on a small reservoir or something like that. The tactics I'm going to show you today will work really well. So let's get straight into it and have a little talk and look at my tackle. Now, as you can see behind me, the canal here is probably, I would say, 30, 35 metres wide. Nice bit of width to it. The depth, well, it's sort of about 10 foot, 12 foot at its deepest down the middle, and then it gets shallower as you go across to the far side. So I've got two rods. One is going to be in that deeper water, sort of two thirds of the way across the canal, and one's going to be in the shallower water across, because whenever you go fishing on a venue where you can get in different depths of water, it's very important to be prepared for those depths, because you never know where the fish are going to be. My tackle is very similar for both. So I'm going to pick one of my rods up. Both my rods are 11 foot Superior SLs. These are really nice soft rods, which when I'm fishing this sort of venue, this is what I want. I don't want great big heavy casting rods. I want a rod with a beautiful action through the rod. And these SLs definitely do that. So at 11 foot, they're going to do the job perfectly. So I've just got two of them. You can see I've got my extremity reels. Wouldn't be about them for my feeder fishing when it comes to this style of fishing. And I've got some 012 absolute feeder braid here on my reel. Now, I love fishing with braid when it's on these venues. I just love the directness to the rod. If you get a chance to fish with braid, please try it, because it's so exciting. So if you're going for a day's pleasure fishing, then it's more enjoyable. You feel every single kick of the fish. But if you're match fishing, braid gives you ultimate control. So that's why I've got braid on my reels. I have got a shock leader on. I've got 10 pound sinking feeder mono, no messing around with my shock leader. I want something nice and durable. And effectively the shock leader is dead simple. It's 6 meters long. I measure out my shock leaders at 6 meters long. And then if I break off, I can just bash another one on. No problem whatsoever. Okay, so really, really easy. The setup down at the business end is a rig that you've hopefully seen me do a few times before. If you haven't, you can go on YouTube and watch any of our rig videos. I've talked about feeder rigs a lot in the past, so you can see how these rigs are made. But effectively, I've got a free running swivel. I love the waggler link swivels, actually, personally, for my feeder fishing. I've got a very, very short length here of 1 mil silicone, and that's got a number 8 stop underneath it. So effectively, the swivel just slips down to the stop, and I've got this little piece of silicone which just slides over the top and keeps it all nice and tidy. And then I've got 6 inches of twizzled line at the bottom. So a really, really simple rig. And free running is going to be the name of the game. Now, when I'm approaching these types of venues, I need to think about the feeders I'm going to use. And my feeder selection becomes simpler and simpler all the time. Fortunately, at Preston, we've made some fantastic feeders, so you can make your choices really easy and get your feeders to do whatever you want. Because this venue isn't particularly deep, maximum, like I say, 10, 12 foot, I've gone for two styles. First of all, got the hex mesh rockets. These feeders are going to help me introduce amounts of bait to the peg. So when I want to introduce maybe, say, a cloud of ground bait or some casters and worms, I'm going to use this style of feeder. And today I'm only fishing 30 meters, so I've got them in 20 gram. Okay, you can use 30 if the wind got up. Obviously they come in lots of bigger sizes, but for me, I just need a 20 grammer, and I've got a medium in my hand. I've got a large one here in case I want to put a large amount of bait in on one of the pegs. So they're going to be my sort of feeding feeders, if you like. Maybe if the fishing's really good, I might fish with one of those feeders on. And then I've got the cage window. And this is what I'm going to use to fish with. I've got these in medium and in the small. I'll make my mind up while I'm fishing. If the fishing's good, I'll have the medium on. If the fishing's a little bit harder, I'll have the small on. And again, I've got 20 gram. That's going to be more than enough for me to cast across this venue. I haven't got the solid feeder today. Personally, I think when the water's shallow like this, I like a little bit of break off. So that cage is going to allow the bait to break down really quickly. Across on the other side, it's probably only 5 foot deep. So again, I need that cage style feeder. So you can see my feeder choice is so easy, and everything about what I'm doing today is going to be really, really straightforward. And then finally, I've got to look at my hook and hook lengths. Now, for feeder fishing, I am an absolutely huge fan of what I'm going to call a straight style point on my hook. And our hook for doing that is the N20. Now, the N20 is a hook that I've used loads and loads, and I've spent hours tying my own box of N20s. I've got absolutely loads tied in here. But fortunately at Preston Innovations, they must have heard my moaning, and they've done us some pre-tied N20s, okay? Brilliant range of hooks. I'm going to start on a 16 to 011. I've also got some 14s to 013 with me, which hopefully, once I'm slaying a few bream later, I'm going to be changing to that 14 hook. So I'm going to start on one of those. They come at a meter in length. Probably won't start on it that long. I'll probably half that to about 50 centimeters. Put one of those on and I'll be ready to fish. Let's have a look at how I'm going to feed that peg. Now I've got a lovely selection of baits on my side tray with me today. Typical bream fishing. Got some casters. Love going using casters for bream, particularly on these big sort of venues. There's a lot of fish in these venues, and sometimes you need these particles to hold your fish. Got some dead maggots. Nice selection of dead maggots. These are only going to be hook bait only, really. Nothing, just a mixed colour, so I can just pick one out what I fancy at the time. And then I've got some worms. Now, worms for me form the main approach of my bream attack. I brought half a kilo with me today. I've chopped some up here in my little sieve, nice and fine. You can see I've chopped them up nice and fine. That'll probably give me enough to last most of the session, to be fair. Now, how am I going to approach this session? Now, I've got my bomb out, chucked my bomb around, and I've found that there's probably about 10 foot of water around about 2/3 of the way across, and then it starts to become shallower. So my first line is going to be there in that 10 foot of water. All right. The reason being, I want to target the deeper water. I feel like the deeper water is an area where it's going to hold a few fish. But if you look across the canal, you can see there's some beautiful trees on the far side. In fact, all the way along this stretch, there's trees on the far side. So for me, that's probably going to be an area where fish naturally patrol. They give a little bit of cover, and often you can catch one or two there at the start. So chucked across there and I found about 5-6 foot of water. And I've got a line there as well, hence why I've got the two rods. Now, I'm actually going to start in the shallower water. That's where I want to start fishing. So I need to feed that far line first, and then I'm going to feed down on that middle line, that sort of 2/3 distance line. And I've put on for this, for fishing across, a medium rocket, okay, the medium hex mesh rocket, because all I'm going to do is I'm going to feed one feeder full of ground bait. My mix is nice and dry. I'm just going to get a small little dollop of worms, literally hardly anything there at all, right? I'm going to pop that in the middle of my dry ground bait. I'm going to get my hex mesh feeder, and I'm barely nipping this in. I'm just giving it a little squeeze there, look. So if I swizzle that around, you can see that little bit of worms trapped in there. Really nice dry ground bait mix. And I'm just going to fire one of these across the canal, just one, because this is where I'm going to start my fishing, okay? Right, probably talking, I don't know, 6-8 feet off those trees. Really nice, give it a little shake. So now I've sort of put a little explosion of worms and ground bait there across. That's almost like a bit of a head start, because now I've fed that line across there, I can just take this off. You notice I haven't got any hook lengths on yet, by the way, because I'm effectively pre-baiting the peg. I'm going to get my line for down the middle, and I'm going to get that large feeder, all right, that large hex mesh rocket feeder. And this time I'm going to be a lot more aggressive. So this is the line where I think I'm going to catch a few fish, and I want the fish to almost settle a little bit on some bait. So I'm going to put 4 feederfuls in, and each one's going to have a blob of worms like that, and probably around, I don't know, 10-15 casters, something like that. And I'm going to feed that now. 4 feederfuls in that dry mix. I'm going to let each one get to the bottom. I'm not going to sort of empty it or try and do anything to draw any fish. I just literally want to put a bed of nice active ground bait on the bottom. All right, so we'll just let that hit the bottom. Watching my tip. It's got to the bottom. Big shake of the rod. Make sure all my bait's out. And the reason I'm doing that is because I want, it's deep, and I'm not going on this line straight away. I don't really want to try and draw any fish onto this line. I just want to put some bait in there so some fish can come and have a little look, find this line, and maybe settle on a little bit of bait. Again, just squeeze that in again. Fire that out. Lovely, absolutely beautiful. Let it hit the bottom. All right, I don't, sometimes, you know, if you want to draw fish in, you might decide to perhaps empty that out a little bit further out, but not for me. I want to get those fish down to the bottom. I want them there. I don't want the bait all drifting off on this deep canal. So that's two. It doesn't take you very long at all. As you can see, it's not a long process. It's just a case of putting a bit of bait in and making sure that the fish have got something to have a bit of a munch on, because I'm probably going to spend at least 30, 45 minutes across. You know, even if I don't catch anything, it's just to allow this bit of bait to settle down the middle. That's the idea behind it, you see. So nice little shake of the rod again, just gets that bait out. One more, and you know, I probably ended up feeding there what you would expect to feed on a pole. Let's have a look. I would say probably this much worm, all right? And I've probably fed that many casters, which if I was gonna go pole fishing and feed a line for some bream, I'd probably put four balls in with that sort of amount of bait in. That's the sort of thing that I would do. So, you know, I've got that in my mind as well. What would I do in that style of fishing? Because obviously I've spent a long time on this canal fishing with a pole. So I know the sort of thing that you need to do. Again, just let that get to the bottom and shake it out. So there you go. That's how I've started the session. We're gonna get into the session and some fishing, but you're probably wondering a little bit about what this ground bait mix is and how I've gone about doing it. So let's take a little look at that first. When you're out on big natural venues like here on the New Junction Canal, one thing that's really important is to think about your ground bait mix. Now, we all know that fish meal type ground baits for bream and skimmers are really, really important. But on a great big venue like this, it doesn't see quite as much intense fish meal as maybe some of these reservoirs do where they get carp anglers on and things like this. Today, there isn't another angler within 500 yards of me. So I've got to think carefully about my mix. I don't want to overpower the fish with fish meal. So this is the sort of mix I use on a venue like this when I'm targeting bream and skimmers. And it's based around F1 Dark, which is my favorite fish meal ground bait for bream and skimmers. It is the base that I use on any sort of venue. And then you probably heard me before say, I like to strengthen it up with, say, a Thatcher's. Well, today I'm actually gonna do the opposite. I'm gonna weaken it down in terms of fish meal content, and I'm gonna use the new Sweet Skimmer, which is, this ground bait's perfect for it. It's got biscuit and bread and those sorts of things. No fish meal in it, so I can blend the two together. Now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go for a two parts F1 Dark, because like I say, this is the base to my mix. And then what I've put in here, I'm gonna just do one part of the Sweet Skimmer. And for me, that's gonna be the perfect combination, all right? It's just gonna take a little bit of edge off the fish meal and make it not quite as powerful and potent. So if I hold it up there, you can see it's got a beautiful blend of ingredients, all right? It's not just that crushed pellet style ground bait. It's got the breads, the corns, the sugars, the salts, everything in there that bream and skimmers absolutely love. Very, very nice mix. Now, again, I want to think carefully about my ground bait. I'm feeder fishing today, so I don't want to overwet it. I always like to have my ground bait on the dry side when it's on the bank. So I've got some water here, just going to pour a little bit in, not a lot at all. Personally, I'm a huge fan of the drill because it means I can work the ground bait. So apologies for a bit of drilling. That's all it takes. And now I've got a ground bait, which is, I'm going to describe as damp. You can see it's nice and dark. It's got all the particles in it. I can bind it into a ball, but this is going to really, really dry out over the course of the next hour or so. And I'm going to be left with almost like a very, very dry ground bait, but that's what I want because I'm going to add particles to it. When I'm on my side tray, I might dampen it down a little bit. Remember, you can never dry a ground bait out, but you can always wet it up. So for feeder fishing, that's absolutely perfect. What I do then, once that mix is all mixed there, even though I've used my drill, I just bash it on the riddle. Because the only reason you're using your riddle is to make sure that water is distributed evenly through the mix. It's not really to get rid of the lumps, it's just to sort of like make sure that the mix is evenly distributed. And there it is, look. Look at that final mix, absolutely superb. Now, like I say, in an hour's time, this will be really, really dry, but by then I'll be ready to start fishing and I can just tweak this to suit. A beautiful ground bait. Right, we've fed the peg, we've looked at the ground bait, want to start the session off. Got my small window feeder on to start the session. I don't know how hard it's going to be. I've put a tiny little bit of worm in my tub here with the dry ground bait and nipped some ground bait in. You can see there, look, the feeder is really nice and tidy. I've got a 16 to the 011 on the pre-tied N20s, and I've gone for double maggot. If you're putting a hook bait on for a bream to start with, I think double maggot's got to be it. I'm going to start across. Like I said before, I think that's my best chance of an early one, fishing across to the far side. So let's just have a fling across. Oh yes, loving it. So I think that's a good chance of one there. Nice little feeder, not sort of crashing it in. You've got to remember all these bream and skimmers, they're not going to want a big heavy feeder crashing in on their head all the time. All right, so I'm just going to pop this here, get my rod rest sorted out. Actually looks like there's a bit of tow on the canal to start with this morning, so that's nice. Let's pop her on there. You get quite a bit of tow on these canals, on these northern canals. Tends to sort of come and go as the day's going on, really, to be honest. So what I'll do, look at this, I'm not even ready for you, is the stopwatch out. I'm sure I got it out. Yeah, here it is. Stopwatch is out. 5 minutes I'm going to go for. See if we get any indication, see if we get any signs. We'll come back to you and see what's happening. Well, the start of the session's been interesting. I've had sort of half an hour across on that far side just to see if there was an early bream or maybe a skimmer, something like that. And I've had a lot of bites. I had quite a lot of bites, hand-sized skimmers, roach, perch. Really actually quite nice, but it's not the big bream and skimmers. So it might be that today, actually, I get to enjoy a really nice day's fishing for smaller skimmers and roach. But before I sort of settle on that, because it was really good fishing across there, I'm going to have a little look down the middle. Now, I'm going to start on a small hook bait, a little piece of worm. I'll just show you what that is, because I'm just going to get a worm here. Just sort of like an inch long piece of worm, really, because I just think that if there's a bream or skimmer there, he's going to have a munch on it. If it's the same as a cross, if I just hold that up there, look. If it's the same as a cross and there's smaller fish, hopefully I'll get some bites from them as well. So a little bit of worm in my window feeder. Let's just see if there's any bites there, because when you haven't been fishing a line, there's a chance there might be some bigger fish there, but it might even be better than a cross for all these bites. Now I'm going to actually hold on to the rod, because bites have been coming quite quickly across. So let's see, let me tighten up my rod. There's a lovely bit of tow on the water, so the tip sort of naturally tightens up. And sometimes on these canals, look at that straight away. My tip's moving straight away. So this, I think there's a I've got a fish there straight away. There's a big head of like small fish feeding today, which is great. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's absolutely brilliant. You know, it looks like we're gonna have a lovely day's fishing. It might be that a few bonus fish move in later on. This is just a small perch, this one. Might be that a few bonus fish move in later on, hopefully. So I'm going to have to try and work at it to try and get that to happen. I've had, I've had some nice sort of hand-sized skimmers across. That's my first chuck there. Greedy little perch just mullered that piece of worm. I'm going to put the same hook bait on again. It might be that I have to maybe put a bigger hook bait on to sit it out for a bream. It might be that I just have to sort of take what comes and hopefully some will move in. You know, you can't ever go fishing and just rely on one thing, which is why it's nice having, you know, a nice range of hooks. I've still got the 16 on. Maybe I need to put a bigger, heavier hook on with heavier line, 14 or even a 12, if I wanted to sit and wait for a bream. But to be honest, I just like getting bites when I'm going feeder fishing, so I'm quite happy to sit here and see what this peg brings over the next 10, 15, 20 minutes, something like that. You know, there's never any rush. Like I said, I've had 30 minutes across, probably caught three hand-sized skimmers, three or four roach, missed a couple of bites like you do. So it'll be interesting to see if this line in the deep water does the same. I didn't catch any perch across actually, so that was my first perch of the day. But it's why having the braid and the soft rod is also important, because you just want to try and put a nice bag of fish together, really. That's the key. So I'll have this sort of 20, 30 minutes here. If it's still small fish, we'll maybe look at the little details of that and see if we can look at how you can enjoy that day small fish fishing and see how you can put more of those sort of fish in the net. But as with any fishing trip, you never know what's going to happen. So we'll have to see. So two chucks, a perch, then a little indication, and we've got something bigger on here. Could be a perch, could be a, oh no, it is, it's a decent skimmer. Hoi, look at that. Yes, get in there. Just when I chucked the feeder out that time, I didn't have the same sort of indications that I had when I was on the first couple of chucks. I didn't get any little fish indications, and I thought, there's a chance, you know, we'll have some big fish here. Now, I didn't change my hook bait or anything. I still got that small piece of worm on. It's only a couple of chucks. If actually, hopefully it'll still be on the hook so I can show you. There you go, look. Just have that small piece of worm on still. That's a lovely, I'd say, pound and a half skimmer. Typical of what I was expecting or hoping to catch today, really. So hopefully there'll be a few more of those. Obviously, that deeper water is where the fish feel a little bit more comfortable. You'll notice there, I just pushed the landing net to the side. When you're on a canal or you've got any sort of towpath behind you, even though I haven't actually had anybody come walking past yet today, you know, if you get a bike come hurtling along or something like that, try to keep stuff off the towpath. So I always keep my net to the side when I'm fishing on a canal like this. I'm gonna have another go. Same sort of hook bait. I'm gonna just find a little piece of, like a smaller worm, I think. I'm going to nip it. I'm going to nip the piece in half, and I'm going to put two small pieces on. That might just be a little bit more attractive to those skimmers, but I'm really pleased about that, because, like I say, I chucked in that time, and there wasn't the same little taps and that I've had. Let's have a chuck in again. Just got that 20 gram cage window on. Goes in nice and light, not a big disturbance. It's got a nice small amount of worms and casters in. Just everything dead nice, really. How you'd like to think that fishing could be. You've got to remember, with any bream and skimmer fishing, you know, you tend to get little runs of fish. It's very rare that you sort of catch 20 in 20 chucks. You know, they are rare red letter days. The likelihood is you'll catch one, two, three, then you might not catch anything for a little while, might go back to the small fish, and you've got to do things to try to attract them back in your peg, which is why I love my feeder fishing so much, because you have to think about it all the time. So there we go, just set a nice little, I don't want a massive bend in my tip, but like I say, the natural toe on this canal today, start my stopwatch. The natural toes just give me a little bend in my tip. I'm very confident now. Now we've just had that one, because, like I say, I chucked in before, a little perch straight away. I had an indication the next chuck, and then that skimmer. And I haven't caught any of the small skimmers or roach yet on this line. So it might be that they were living in that shallower water across. It might be that they felt more comfortable over there in the shallow water. And by giving myself an option in the deeper water, I'm hoping that even if I have to wait a little bit longer for bites, it might be those bigger fish, like the one you just saw me catch. So you're already seeing why it's so important to have those two different depths to go at as well. So we've got a decent fish the next chuck as well. We've got about 3.5 minutes on the stopwatch, which is what I would expect, you know, sort of nice time to let it settle, but decent fish this is. Nice to, beautiful to be catching these, you know, springtime style fishing. You don't ever really know what to expect. Hopefully it's another nice skimmer, but oh, it is. Oh, I'll tell you what, I'm giving that bream status. There he is, look. Hey, look at that, absolute bonus. What's amazing is those two lines are really paying off for me because they didn't want to be in that shallower water at all. They obviously wanted to be in that deep water. Now they might move later on, but in the sunlight, look at his colours there. He has got some beautiful colours. Not that traditional brown colour that you get on some venues. They're quite a sort of silvery colour here, but you can see all his back is all green. What a warrior. What a warrior. He's a good 2.5 pound ears, so let's just slip him into the net. What a session. What a start to the session. We're about 45 minutes in. That little bit of bait that we put into that deeper water has obviously just settled down a little bit. The old bream's not up my line. Look, that'll wipe off. Tell you what I'm going to go for. That was on a little piece of worm. I've got some red worms. I'm going to get a red worm and I'm just going to hook it on. I'm going to nip it in half. That's what I'm going to do. So I've got two little halves of red worms on there. Get a few more worms and casters. Nip them into my feed. I'm going to nip them in quite tight actually at the moment because I don't want the fish drifting off. So I'm going to nip that in quite tight. I actually don't mind if a little bit stays in this chuck. Don't want to overdo it with the feed because I don't think that they're ravenous feeders at the moment. What a beautiful way to be fishing on a venue like that. It's probably about 20 meters I'm casting there, I'd say, something like that. Not particularly far. I haven't actually sticked it up today because I'm on this nice little narrow canal and I just found where I felt was right with my plummet. Just having a nice day's fishing on, you know, these sorts of fish. So tighten that up again. Can put my rod on my rod rest now. I'm not going to hold my rod anymore because I feel like there is some bigger fish in my peg. Just going to keep tightening it up right down to the feeder. So I feel now that's right down to the feeder. And I just slide it along my rod rest to the end. So my tip's got a tiny little bend in it. Start my stopwatch. Always like to get everything set. It's a bit weird. I always like to get everything set and then I start my stopwatch. That's my little routine that I personally have. Just gives me an opportunity to get everything set up and I get a rough idea for when that bite comes after being set up. But I think it's going to be important just to keep putting in that little bit of bait without cage window. If I start catching a bit more regularly, I might put a bigger feeder on. I might introduce a bit more bait, but I'm just not quite feeling that today. I feel like those amount, that amount of small fish that was across there, I'm not quite sure if it needs piling in loads of bait. Well, I've just been working down that middle line and had some nice fish, to be honest. I've had 2 or 3 bream, a couple of skimmers, really nice fish, and it's not solid. I'm having to sort of like catch a few and then go through a little period where you don't catch one and we might be taking a few pictures for the camera or something like that. And I can just tell that the fish are there, but you can't seem to just hammer them. And this is what often I do find when I'm feeder fishing. Those days are very rare when you can just catch one after another. So this is where the two lines come into effect. So I thought I would show you a little bit about how I like to fish on this far line, because I've sort of identified that the chances are that I might get a bonus fish early on that far line, but the chances are those little smaller skimmers and that are going to come in, roach, because they're coming into that shallower water. So I'm going to use that far line just to rest this sort of two-thirds line down the middle now. Now, when I'm fishing across over there, I probably want to cast a little bit more regular. There's lots of small fish. But if you're going to cast regular, you've got to be careful. I don't want to be ploughing loads of bait in. So what I've actually done is I've just wetted up, look, a bit of the ground bait, and I've flicked in, got like a tiny bit of worm like that, and I'm just going to flick that in and give it a mix around. So I would say every time I load the feeder, there's an odd piece of worm in there, and I'm just going to nip that in my ground bait, and I'm going to nip that into the feeder like that. Now look, not really filled the feeder up, just a little squidge of a tiny bit, nice and soft. I've put two little tiny bits of red worm on the hook, and I'm just going to start casting in every sort of 2-3 minutes with effectively what is a little bit of ground bait. I tell you what, I've got some lovely white bits of fluff on my line now by the looks of things. I'm just going to cast regular. I'm going to keep chucking in that 2-3 minutes. I've actually put a 30 gram feeder on this because there's so much sort of like little bits of white fluff on the surface. It's actually holding my reel and rod up a little bit. So what I've actually had to do is put a slightly heavier feeder on to make sure it sort of powers through all that stuff. When you're on natural waters like this, these sort of things can happen at times. So you've got to be thinking about how you can sort of cope with it. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to be patient, but busy. So that's going to sound a little bit contradictory, but I see too many people, when they think they've got to start winding in for small fish, they're in and out, like, you know, crazy. And you can easily ruin your fishing. So I'm still going to sort of wait 2-3 minutes between my casts. And that way I will build a peg, but I won't overdo it. You know, if you start sort of missing little bites and getting carried away, before you know it, you've had that many casts in your peg's all over the place. So you've still got to have an element of patience about you. But it'll be nice to potentially rest this far line, or rest this middle line, should I say, by using this far line. If I could catch a pound or two, a little smaller fish, or even maybe a bonus bream, you never know, then it'll have done its job, because hopefully I'll be able to drop back down the middle and then catch another couple of bream there. So you just got to be prepared to work it. Feeder fishing, in my opinion, if you're just going to pick one hole and chuck it down one hole all day, you're going to have odd times when there's a few fish there. But personally, I think by utilising bits of your canal or bits of the venue that you're at like this, you're definitely going to put more fish in your net as a result. Well, I did suspect this might be the case. We were just coming towards the end of the first chuck, and I've got a slightly better fish on here, probably a decent skimmer. You'll be amazed how many times that happens. You go back on a line after it's settled down, and you get that bigger fish first chuck in. This is the first chuck in. We literally just set about thinking, oh, we'll do 3 or 4 nice quick chucks for you so you can see what's going on. There it is, look. 3-pounder, it looks like to me, under the water. Lovely when you can see him nice and clear. There he is, look. Hey. So earlier, it was all small fish on this line. Have they had a chance to settle? I'd probably say that's the biggest fish of the day so far. Real proper fish, look at that. Proper old fish, got a few spawning marks on it at the moment. Really had my bait, 2 little bits of worm. You know, this is what can happen. Now, I've got to be honest, I'd be really surprised if I now caught 3 or 4 from there. Hey, you know, this is fishing, anything could happen, but I would be surprised. My sort of thoughts now would be, well, that's brilliant because I've allowed my middle line to have a rest. I've caught that bonus fish. And if I could back that up now with, I don't know, 4 or 5 little fish, I'd be really happy. If I get another bream, fantastic. But this is why those lines are so important. You know, it's so important to keep your options open and keep an open mind on what could happen and be prepared to rotate. I really can't stress that enough. That was on two little small pieces of red worm. That was sort of almost designed for fishing for small fish. Same mix, that soft mix. Well, you saw me load it. There you go, I'm gonna just do exactly the same again. And like I say, it is amazing how often giving it that little rest just results in a fish. So let's have a go again. You know, sometimes you can go on a line, catch two or three really quickly. I mean, that just hasn't been the case. I think I'm up to five now, five what I would call proper over 2 pound fish. You know, that's really good. And I've got another sort of 10 or 12 smaller skimmers and some roach and that. You know, we're only halfway through a session. Yep. Just getting a bite there. I've got another one on. Look at that. That is as quick as that. I was just setting my tip and I could see the rod going, and that's another one. So that has surprised me, but two in two when you go back on it. I mean, how lucky am I? But don't answer that in the comments below. I know it can sometimes happen, but you never know. Might get three or four, five or six. But two in two after a rest, I've probably been, I'd say, nearly an hour on that middle line. So no bait on this line for a good hour. And I've just gone in on it. That one's not quite as big, look. Probably two pounder. Yes. What a fantastic day's fishing. And it's all coming together. That's still on that 16 N20. Just come out in the net there. Even better. Less faffing around for me. There you go, pound and a half. Straight away, you saw how quick that was. Literally dropped back in. Imagine if you're in a match and you've just gone in, you've had a 3 pounder, pound and a half, all within that short space of time. I suppose you might as well stick with me for another one, eh? Let's see if we can get another one. I'm not sure what's, I'd be flabbergasted, but stranger things have happened. But that's how quickly it can happen. When you rest a swim like that, I did say that we'd have a chance of getting one or two. Well, certainly one. I felt there was a good chance of getting one after giving it a rest like that. But I must admit that two is less likely. Right, same again, two little pieces. I'm going to just put that same mix in. Why not? It's only got an odd little bit in. All right, look, same again. Got a lot of this white fluff on my line, that dandelion stuff that gets on the water, and it gets caught on your braid all the way round. So just going to be quite aggressive here with my cast, just to try and make, you can actually hear it going through the rings, you see, just to make sure I get there. Rod down, see if I can get it on the rest this time. Didn't even get a chance to get it on the rest. I'm just trying my, oh, it's a small fish. Got excited there. Ah, look at that. Look how those fish have gathered on that far line. This is more like what I expected. I expected one bonus fish and then I expected these. This is what I expected to come in after that one. So we were lucky we got away with two bonus fish. Look, nice pommy. What fantastic fishing you can have on these sort of venues. Absolutely brilliant. I'm looking at my worms. They actually look all right, because it had it so quickly. So I'm gonna have a quick chuck again. Obviously, if bites are good, maybe a bit lazy on my part, maybe I should change it, but because you guys are here, let's have another chuck. That bait looks all right to me, I think. Again, just a nice firm punch. Brilliant, I absolutely love it when a plan comes together. So I've just chucked back down the middle. Enjoyed that little run across. Obviously we caught those two bonus bream. I then went on to catch six or seven small fish. I was quite enjoying it actually, but I was probably on it for about 30 to 40 minutes. And I've got to be honest, got to be careful when you're swapping lines. If you're gonna have an area where you want to catch some bream, sometimes I'm a bit nervous about leaving it too long. As it happens, when we went across, there was a couple of bream there, but you know, if I want to catch sort of any sort of amount of fish in this last period, I still feel that that deeper water is my best bet, because, you know, early doors, I could tell that's where they felt most comfortable. Now, if not, it doesn't matter, because I'm going to obviously give that far line now a chance to rest again. But I'm back on this, and I'm not going to cast as regular. I'm going to be 5-minute casts. This is my, like I said, my first cast. We're a couple of minutes into it. I haven't had any indications yet at all, which I'm not actually that fussed about, because, you know, I didn't really want to go on this line and get bitted out by small fish. I wanted to go on this line and hopefully there's an odd bream or two kicking about. Like I say, there's a chance that there might not be, and they could have drifted off. So if there isn't any fish there, I'll then pick this hex mesh feeder up and put probably two or three, the medium one, feederfuls in of like worms and casters, because I think that it'll be clear to me that those fish have drifted off, and then I can go back across. So just to give you an idea of the timings, I'm not going to spend ages here without a bream. I'm going to say I've got 3, maybe 4, 5-minute casts to see if I can catch one here. Because if not, I'm quite happy to go back across and potentially nick another one. I can guarantee a few small fish. But what I don't want to do is just sit on this line for like hour, 2 hours waiting for bream to arrive. It's just not how I like to fish. I like to get plenty of bites, enjoy my fishing. And if I can catch 6, 7, 8, 9 bream, whatever that might be today, but by doing it over a couple of lines, I just get a lot more satisfaction than waiting for that sort of turn up of maybe 4 bream and 4 chucks, because for a start off, they don't always want to turn up while you're fishing it. So we're just about coming to the end of this first chuck. So I'll just show you, might have a little perch or something on there, or there was a little perch or something, picked it up there as I just picked up the bait. Maybe a couple of little indications. Yeah, I had a little perch or something give me an indication on the bait there. So with that in mind, I'm just gonna get a dendrobina, not a massive one. And I'm gonna hook the end of that dendrobina and give myself sort of like an inch or so. Look, nice small piece of worm. You've got to remember, most of the time, you're only feeding small bits of worm, small bits of chopped up worm. So there's not always a need to put a bit in. And I'm quite aggressive on this line. Like, I'm using more bait than I am across, because I feel like I do want them to get their heads down and catch 3 or 4 if they do come on this line. So each feederful has got a nice amount of bait in, if you like. But I'll only have those 3 or 4 chucks. And that's another reason why I can be quite generous with the bait. For example, if I'm not, you know, if I don't catch anything in these 3 or 4 chucks, at least I have put some bait in, and then I can put, like I say, a couple of hex meshes over the top. You know, you can always be positive on that line. A little indication there as I was sinking the rod. Just keep an eye on that, I think. Little indication again. That could be a perch or something down there. Hopefully not. Hopefully something a little bit better. But this is what I mean. You know, you don't know how it's going to work out. You don't know how your day's going to pan out. And I love just trying to work those lines and get the best out of them all the time. You can see it's a dead easy approach. It's not been anything complicated. You know, we've already got well in excess of 20 pound on a canal. You know, that's a lovely springtime day's fishing. I've got to be honest. Little taps here, really. So I love it. I love it when the tip's doing something, when there's indications, because you can try to figure out what's going on. Because if that is just small little perch, again, little taps, and well, they've got a little tiny fish on or nothing at all. Yeah, a little tiny fish. You know, we'll see what this is here. Just obviously tells me straight away, you know, that there's a lack of bream. Oh, nice roach, look at that. That's my first sort of silverfish, if you like, down the middle. Which, I mean, I always think roach are a classic sign that there's not loads of bream in your peg. Great to catch and love fishing for them, but you rarely sort of go bream, bream, roach, roach, bream. It doesn't work like that, you know. You tend to find when those smaller fish are in your peg that that's not going to be the case. So We might not be ending on a bream today, but what we can do is work these two lines. Again, just nip that bait in my feeder. See, what can often happen as well when you're chucking in regularly with roach, before you know it, there'll be lots of bait in your peg, activity from you casting in, and really that's not quite right for the bream as well. So we'll see, we'll just give this a final sort of 10-15 minutes, see if I can finish with a bream, either here or across, and we'll wrap it up. Well, it took three or four casts, but we've got a better one. To be honest, it seems like it's slowed down a little bit. Maybe this will be the start of two or three, but a great way to finish for you guys. I hope you've seen today the importance of rotating your pegs and working your lines, all right? Because without a doubt, if I've sat and waited on a line, it's just not happened. Whereas every time I've sort of made that little change, there he is, look, made that little change, it's resulted in one or two of these better fish. And we've ended up with well over 20 pound of fantastic bream and skimmers on the new Junction Canal, which is a great day's fishing by anyone's imagination. But I've not finished yet. Unfortunately, I've got to leave you. I'm going to catch a few more of these. I hope you've enjoyed this video. I'll catch you on the next one.